Well, we do have some expectations about life. And I think the first question is not so much life expectancy, but what do we expect? What is our expectation of what we're doing? Who we are? In other words, longevity for what? And so many folks are focused on longevity in a very more materialistic way. Well, I just want to live longer. Well, that isn't really the fullest picture that we can be as full human beings, because we are put, from all the great traditions, we're put here on the planet to know God and to merge with God and become enlightened. So in the great traditions, we look at the purpose of life expectancy is to live long enough to wake up spiritually and become enlightened. There was a great being, Tapasini Maharaj, who lived to be 186. And at 100, he did kayakalpa and did all these processes for a year, and he came out looking like he was 20 years old. And then he did it several more times, and he eventually woke up into enlightenment, self-realization, and of course then he stopped doing it because he achieved his purpose. So what's our purpose? That's the first thing. So what are we expecting? More important than life expectancy. That being said, it is possible for humans to live beyond 120. That to me is a lowest expectation. If we're living in harmony, if we're living with what I mentioned last week, the six limitations, the sevenfold peace, we have a foundation to do that. And does it matter? It only matters if you kind of have a bigger view. Materialistically, if you don't get it, you don't get the purpose of life, what does it really matter? It becomes more like getting more involved in the ego. And so that's where that question comes up. Now, we do know that the most important things for life expectancy actually is a low insulin. And the people, the one thing we seem to know all around the world is the people who live the longest have the lowest fasting insulin. And what that means is they really have the lowest carbohydrate intake. That's the one thing that seems to unify people around the world in terms of how, you know, the statistics are. There's some people that worry. There's some people who are calm. There's a, you know, people do have a lot of different kind of qualities. But the one thing that seems to be common in all the cultures is a relatively low sugar intake, complex or simple carbohydrate. And the diet that, what I call the Enlightenment diet, really is designed to be a moderate fat and moderate low protein and moderate low carbohydrate, mostly just simply greens, and a little bit of your high quality cherries, berries, and also some citrus. Those are the fruits that I have are super packed with the phytonutrients and all the qualities that you get from foods, all the rainbow qualities that are in these fruits. And so the berries and cherries and citrus pretty much cover us. And there's a few other fruits, but those are it. So that diet works really well to support a low complex carbohydrate intake. Discussion is a little complex, so let's go back to the great traditions. I look often through the eyes of the great traditions. The Genesis 129 say your diet should be, you know, a live food, plant source only diet. The Taoist masters, the yogic masters, the rishis, all mentioned, the Sumerians mentioned this too, of being the vegetarian. So for about 1600 years before the flood, you had pretty much a live food, I'm going to say plant source only diet. Now, around that time and after that time, we have Herodotus, who's known as the father of history. And Herodotus actually said, he cites the Pelagians, as were 100% livelihood and lived on an average of 200 years. So that's a little clue about longevity there. And they lived in southern Greece, about 3000 BC. And I actually researched it up because that sounded pretty interesting. And sure enough, when I began lecturing in Greece, and I ran into a naturopath there, and she knew all about the Pelagians, and I was able to locate it into southern Greece. So they really did exist. And another culture are the Essenes. The Essenes, in their time, on the average, according to Pliny the Elder, and also Josephus, lived about 120 years, where the rest of the society was maybe 40 years. So that was very significant. And there, at the core, they were vegetarian, they were plant source only, and they were live. And so that group of people had a phenomenal long life. And it's said that in the 5th century B.C., up on Mount Carmel, Pythagoras trained with them, and he came down enlightened and teaching live foods. And he then brought the live food in more into the Western culture. But again, remember, he's Greek and Pelagians were there, so he had to know about them too. So that was interesting. And then we have a lot of long-lived people in different places around the planet, like the Hunzas and so forth. I can't tell you that they're 100% plant source only, because I don't think they were. And the Mayan Indians and also the Tarahumaras. And so there are groups here and there were relatively long-lived. And of course, you have the people in Okinawa as well. So, but I'm more interested in seeing the big picture is that originally, according to in this cycle of the Adamic race, we had at least 1,600 years where the whole world, or at least the whole Middle East, and that we can't tell, was actually live food. And we do have evidence of cultures doing this, like the Pelagians, like the Essenes, all the way up to the Mormons, believe it or not, who their core inner 25 people were on 100% live foods. So these are things to consider when we look at the whole picture. We don't really have a limitation when people start counting calories, how many calories are protein, how much of this and how many. Doesn't matter. What matters is as you move into this whole assimilation thing, what we begin to do is assimilate more and more energy and see food as energy. It's a love note from God. It's also an energetic love note from God, which really then makes it possible to transcend our materialistic view of how much we should eat. So ultimately that takes us back to longevity, and longevity is a state of mind. I think the factors that I see are important are your diet. The other thing is exercise. It makes a very, very big important on longevity. And the third, as I would say, is really love in your life and your connection to other people. There is research that suggests in studying different communities, the longer-lived community people are usually living in community in some level. And that adds a few years to the life. So those are key things. Now the other statistic, which really comes from non-vegetarian sources, but basically says plant source only diets generally increasing your lifespan by 3 to 7 years.